Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you. And the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
Oh, when shall I see Jesus and reign with him above, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning, and from the flowing fountain drink everlasting love, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shout glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Gird on the gospel armor of faith and hope and love, and you'll hear the trumpet sound in that morning. And when the combat's ended, he'll carry you above, and you'll hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shout glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Our ears shall hear with transport the host of heaven sing, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Our tongues shall chant the glories of our immortal King, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shout glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet sound in that morning. When I hear the trumpet sound in that morning.
I want to study with you today for a few minutes about the work of ministers and writers. Now, probably several of you are saying, well, what in the world? I'm not a minister or writer, and I'm never going to be, so why does this apply to me? You're going to find out in a minute it applies to every single person here, especially the children, but also the adults, because a lot of people don't know what the work of a minister and a writer is. We're going to find out in just a moment what the Lord has in mind for ministers and writers to do and what effect it is to have on other people. Let's pray before we begin. Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege that we have to be in your house on your holy day, and we want to give you thanks that you have preserved for us up until this present time the religious liberty and civil liberty that we enjoy in this country, that we have freedom of assembly, and that we can come of our own free will to worship you on your holy day as you have specified. And we pray that your spirit will be here and that each of us will hear that still small voice and that we will understand what you're trying to teach us. May our worship be in spirit and in truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We covered, actually, what the work of a minister is in our scripture this morning. When we read Amos, the fourth chapter, it didn't seem like the prophet's mission and message were having the effect that it was supposed to have. But he told Israel what they were supposed to do, and he told them, he said, God has sent you judgment after judgment after judgment. All these things, why are all these awful things happening? Well, God's trying to wake you up. But you don't wake up. And then, after he specifies all of these different judgments that the Lord has sent, notice what he tells them they should do. Look in verse 12. It says, therefore, thus will I do to you, O Israel, and because I will do this to you, prepare to meet your God, O Israel. Because I'm going to do these things, judgment is coming, you better get ready. You better prepare to meet your God. Do you realize, friend, that each one of you has an appointment? It's not an appointment that you have made. It is an appointment that God has made for you. Now, you're all aware of the fact that parents have the authority to make appointments for their children. Is that true? Do parents have the authority to make appointments for their children? Yes, they do. Heavenly Father has the authority to make an appointment for us, and He's made one. He's made an appointment for each one of you. Each one of you are going to meet your Creator face to face, eyeball to eyeball. You're going to be looking right at each other. Now, since you have this appointment, would you like to be ready? That's what the prophet says. He says, prepare to meet your God. Because you're going to. God has already made an appointment. You are going to meet Him face to face. We often talk about it as the day of judgment or the great white throne judgment or the day of final judgment, however you want to describe it. You and I are going to meet our Maker face to face. That is reality. It has already been decided that that's going to happen. Ellen White was writing about this, and this is what she said. This is in a pamphlet that she wrote in this pamphlet. She said, the work of ministers and writers is to prepare a people to meet God. So what is the work of a minister and a writer? To prepare people to meet God. You're going to meet God whether you're prepared or not. Now, the work of a minister or a writer, she's talking about religious writers. The work of a minister or writer is therefore very solemn and very serious because someday, I don't know the day, he hasn't told me the time, but someday you are going to meet your Maker. I'm going to meet my Maker. And my dear friends, there are going to be many people in that day. They're going to be very angry. The Bible talks about this. You can read it in the last chapters, one of the last chapters in Great Controversy. They're going to be they're going to be angry at their preachers because their preachers did not get them ready. They did not tell them what they needed to do to be ready to meet their Maker. And by the way, the reason it's so serious and so solemn to be engaged in the preaching business or in religious writing is if any preacher does not preach to you from the Word of God what you need to know to be ready for the day of God, what to be ready to meet your Lord, well then the Lord's going to ask him, how come I gave you a responsibility? Notice what Ezekiel said about this. Look in Ezekiel, the third chapter. Ezekiel, the third chapter. And verse 17. Starting. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. Therefore, hear a word from my mouth and give them warning from me. When I say to the wicked, you shall surely die, and you give him no warning, nor speak to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life, that same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. Yet, if you warn the wicked, and he does not turn from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered your soul. So, a minister has the job to warn people. This is wrong. If you go in that direction, you're not going to be ready to meet the Lord. You're going to perish. And we live in a generation when many preachers are afraid to do this because they're afraid maybe their job will be at stake, or maybe they won't get their salary or their pension, or they lose hire. And by the way, ministers are human just like everybody else. If you're a minister, it costs you the same amount of money for a loaf of bread or a gallon of gasoline as it does for anybody else. So ministers, they have the same problems to deal with in the world as everybody else, and ministers don't like to lose their jobs, just like other people don't like to lose their jobs. And so ministers, many of them are afraid to do everything that the Lord told them to do. And so they want to speak smooth things. And the Bible talks about that. There are many texts that we could read, both in the Old and New Testament, about ministers that want to preach smooth things. But the problem with that is that if you don't declare everything, notice what the Apostle Paul did. Look in your Bible in Acts, the 20th chapter. Acts, the 20th chapter. And this is the Apostle Paul speaking to the elders at Ephesus. And he says, look also at verse 31. Watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. And he says in verse 27, I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. He didn't leave anything out. Why didn't he leave anything out? Well, look at verse 26. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all men. What does he mean when he says he's innocent of the blood of all men? Nobody will be able to come to the Apostle Paul in the day of judgment and say, if you had told me that, then I could have been ready. If you listen to what the Apostle Paul says, you will be ready. Because he declared the whole counsel of God. So, we are under obligation. Anyone who preaches is under obligation to tell people what they need to know so that they will be ready, prepared to meet God. I was very interested when I was studying this. I was so impressed with this paragraph that Ellen White wrote that I copied it to my computer. And I copied the file, and then I forgot it. But last week, I ran onto it again. I found it again. And I said, we have to study this. I want to read to you this paragraph. I just read to you the first sentence. I want to read you the whole paragraph and then go down the points that she mentions here. Because she, in this paragraph, she's going to tell you and me what we need to do to be ready for the day of God. She says that's the work of a minister, but then she does it right there in that very paragraph. It's a loaded paragraph. It has almost 10 points. We'll get over as many of them as we can. Here's how the paragraph reads. I think that I will number things so you'll be able to follow the main points, and we'll try to cover as many of these main points as we can. First main point is the work of ministers and writers is to prepare people to meet God. Point number two, she says the standard of truth has been lowered in the dust. What's that talking about? Hope we'll try to spend a minute or two on that one. Point number three, family religion, family holiness is now to be honored as never before. You know what that is? What is family religion? We're going to go over that, what that is, so you'll know exactly what it is. Point number four, as a sanctifier, reprover, and comforter, the Holy Spirit is to do the work essential for this time. There is a work that is essential in your heart and in your life that the Holy Spirit must do. And if the Holy Spirit does not do this work in your life, you will be lost. It is only as she says this work by the Holy Spirit is essential. Now, you all know what something is that is essential. What does that mean? You can't get along without it. You cannot be saved unless the Holy Spirit works in your life as a sanctifier. A sanctifier is somebody or something that makes you holy. That's what a sanctifier is. A reprover and comforter. That was point number four. Point number five. If ever a people needed to walk before God as did Enoch, Seventh-day Adventists need to now. What does it mean to walk with God like Enoch did? Well, we're going to look for a moment at that. Point number six, showing their sincerity by pure words, clean words, words full of sympathy, tenderness, and love. That's loaded, isn't it? My speech. If my speech is not correct, I can't go to heaven. People up there, there are certain ways they don't talk. And so if I don't learn how to talk the way they talk, Enoch learned how to talk the way they talk up there, so he could go. And then point number seven. It is not to end here. There are times when words of reproof and sharp rebuke are called for. Those who are out of the way need more than soft words to bring them back. Moral renovation must take place in every heart, else souls will perish in their sins. Moral renovation. That's an interesting statement. Moral renovation. You know what renovation is. Have you ever, some of you perhaps have tried to renovate a house. My wife and I tried to renovate a house one time. And we were living in the house that we were renovating. My wife told me after we got done, you're not going to do that anymore. I said, okay. But moral renovation has to take place. If it doesn't take place, what will happen to you? You'll perish. You'll perish in your sins. And then, point number eight. If we brought the instruction contained in the 12th chapter of Romans into the practical life, we would be true believers. Now, we're not going to spend time on point number eight, even though it's one of the most important points in this paragraph. And then point number nine. This is the last in this paragraph. Those whose faith is spurious. What does it mean to have your faith spurious? It means it's not the real thing. Those whose faith is spurious will show by their daily exhibition of character that they are not true Christians. Those who have put on Christ are transformed by the renewing of their minds. By their own experience, they prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's a quotation, of course, from Romans 12. Well, let's try to cover as many points as we can. I want to be ready for heaven. You want to be ready for heaven? She says one of the first things mentioned is that the standard of truth has been lowered in the dust. So the standard of truth has got to be raised up because it has been lowered in the dust. Now, what is she talking about? The standard of truth has been lowered in the dust. Let me read a couple statements she wrote these to young preachers. Here, she said, concerning these young preachers, she says, they have been coarse and rough in their manners, making expressions in their conversation which were not perfectly modest and chaste. They are not fit to engage in this work until they give evidence of an entire reform. One word spoken unadvisedly may do more harm than a series of meetings held by them will do good. Now, this illustrates, by the way, a truth that I found very distasteful when I understood it, and I'm understanding more about it, it seems, every day. And did you notice that she said that they could do more harm with a word than they could do good in a whole series of meetings? Did you notice that? It was very painful to me when I began to understand how clearly it was, the truth was, that you can, whether you're talking about finances, your physical health, your mental health, your spiritual health, you can destroy something much quicker than you can build it up. That's just, I've learned that that's reality. And when I found that out, I was not happy to find it out. But it's just the truth. I had to face the truth. It doesn't matter what you're talking about. You can be talking about your physical health, your mental health, your spiritual health, your finances. You can destroy your financial condition much quicker than you can build it back. Much quicker. It's that way with everybody. You can destroy your health much quicker than you can build it back. You can destroy yourself spiritually much faster than you can be built back up. I thought to myself, if there was some way I could help every young person to learn that, it would change the way a lot of people live. Because I deal often with people who that in just a few years when they were teenagers wrecked the whole rest of their life. I can tell you story after story. Remember, my young friend, you can destroy yourself much faster than you can build yourself back up. And that's whether it's your finances, your physical health, your mental health, or your spiritual health. She says these young preachers, they could do more harm with a word spoken unadvisedly than they could in a whole series of meetings. What are these words that are so dangerous? She goes on to say, here it is. She said, by speaking these words, the standard of truth which should ever be exalted is lowered to the dust before the community. And then she says, this is concerning these young ministers, he should see the evil of these careless, rough, vulgar expressions and should put away and despise everything of this character. She goes on to talk about hasty words, unsanctified speech. And she says this, but few realize that they grieve away the Spirit of God by their thoughts and feelings, their nonsense, trifling conversation. Do you want to grieve away the Spirit of God? Do you remember the story of Joseph and Mary? I read it just a few days ago in the book Desire of Ages. When they took Jesus down to the temple when he was 12 years of age, and when they left to go back home, they didn't notice that Jesus was with them. They thought that he was with the group, but they left and they left Jesus there. It took them a lot longer to find him again than it did to lose him. It took them only one day to realize that they had lost him. But it took them 3 days. His mother said to him, my father, your father and I, Joseph and I, we have sought you 3 days, sorrowing. They lost him in one day? 3 days. Actually, that's a pretty good ratio. Usually the ratio is worse than that, as to how fast you can destroy something versus how fast you can build it up. So, by trifling speech, by jesting and joking, the angels of heaven do not stay in the company of people where Jesus is not thought of and is not appreciated. Have you ever thought about that? And so, in a day, you can lose the Holy Spirit. You can lose the association of the heavenly angels. I was just reading. Maybe we should go to the next point where she talks about family religion. We'll get to that one. How you can lose the association of the angels of heaven. That was point number 3. She says family religion, family holiness is now to be honored as never before. What is family religion and family holiness? Now, we do not have time this morning to study this in detail, but I'm going to give you a reference that you can look it up and study it on your own. If you have either volume 4 Spiritual Gifts. If you have volume 4 of Spiritual Gifts, it's around page 9 in there, or the very same article. The very same article is in Volume 1 of Testimonies of the Church, starting on about page 303, and the title of the testimony is Family Religion. Family Religion. I studied it in detail the first year that I was in the ministry, and I was so shocked by what I read in that testimony. I preached about it to the churches that I was pastoring in North Dakota. It's in that testimony that she says how that when we speak to each other at home, if we have words of contention and jangling in our homes, that we are offering an offering to Satan and to his satanic majesty, and the angels will flee from our homes. Read that testimony. It's about 7 pages long. It's full, loaded with information that'll be a help to you in your spiritual walk. Family religion, family holiness. Let me just read to you what this is about. What is family religion? This is from Adventist homepage 94. The conduct of the husband toward the wife and of the wife toward the husband may be such that it will make the home life a preparation for entrance to the family above. Conduct, the way we conduct ourselves. Now, it's not just the husband and the wife, it's also the children. Here it is, page 317, Adventist Home. Family religion consists in bringing up the children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. That's a take from Ephesians 6. Everyone in the family is to be nourished by the lessons of Christ. And the interest of each soul is to be strictly guarded in order that Satan shall not deceive and allure away from Christ. Very interesting. I just read a sentence. Page 317 in Adventist Home. Every member of the family is to be nourished. She's talking about spiritual nourishment. How is every member of the family to be nourished? Every member of the family is to be nourished by the lessons of Christ. How is it with the members in your family? Do the children in your family know all the stories that Jesus told? Do the children in your family know all of the miracles that Jesus worked? How many is that? All the stories and all the miracles that Jesus worked, the total number of both is 75. That's the number. And they're interesting stories and interesting miracles, and it is not hard to memorize them. When my parents told me, and my grandparents told me those stories, after I heard the story one time, I knew the story. And those stories are educational. Those stories tell you what you need to do to be ready for the kingdom of heaven. Family religion. By the way, in your family, not just on Sabbath, but in the days of the week, what do you talk about in your family? Does anybody in your family talk about Jesus during the week? Or is the only time that anybody in your family talks about God or Jesus is on the Sabbath? My friend, the angels of God visit our homes, but sometimes they don't stay. If we don't ever talk about spiritual things, if we don't ever talk about the Lord, if He's not in all of our thoughts, the angels are not attracted and cannot stay in a home where there is no appreciation or nobody ever talks about spiritual things. They don't ever talk about Jesus or about the Lord. So they have no family religion. They have religion on the Sabbath day because they come to church, but they don't have family religion. My parents never claimed to be perfect, and I've never claimed that for them either, but I'll tell you one thing. I cannot ever remember a day in my home, all the time I was growing up, when my father did not have both morning and evening worship. I cannot ever remember such a day. I'm sure that happened sometime when he was sick or I was sick or something happened that we couldn't get, but I can't remember one. So there was never a day in our home when nobody ever talked about the Lord, about Jesus all day long. It's in the morning and the evening, that was a rule. If my father wasn't home, then my mother conducted worship. I was just reading the other day. I didn't bring the reference with me. I should have. Ellen White said that the whole heavenly universe is looking and watching to see which homes have worship in the evening. Now, that's not a direct quote. Which homes in the evening before they go to bed, they talk about the Lord and they pray. How is it in your home? Do you have family religion? Or is the only religion you have church religion? Let's go to point number four. Point number four was this. As a sanctifier, reprover, and comforter, the Holy Spirit is to do the work essential for this time. If ever a people needed to work before God, as did Enoch, Seventh-day Adventists need to now. That's point number five. What is the work of the Holy Spirit? How could it be described in a few sentences? I'll read you an interesting paragraph that's meant a very great deal to me. I just love to read this paragraph. It's in the book Christ Object Lessons, page 162. And this is what it says. You have to read this paragraph several times before it just really hits you. Here's what it says. The work of redemption involves consequences of which it is difficult for man to have any conception. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. 1 Corinthians 2:9. As the sinner, drawn by the power of Christ, approaches the uplifted cross. He's talking about what you do in your imagination. The sinner approaches the uplifted cross and prostrates himself. When you prostrate yourself, you get down, clear down on the ground. As the sinner, drawn by the power of Christ, approaches the uplifted cross and prostrates himself before it, something happens. The next part of the sentence is, there is a new creation. Paul said, I've been trying to understand this text for several decades. I don't claim to understand it yet, but I've been trying. Paul says, if any man be in Christ, old things are passed away. All things have become new. I just quoted part of it. What part did I leave out? If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. All things are become new. When does that happen? I just read it. When the sinner who is drawn by the power of Christ, when he comes to the cross, this is in his imagination, and he prostrates himself before the cross. You know what that means, don't you? I better explain that. If you prostrate yourself in front of somebody, you are acknowledging them as your Lord, as somebody that's superior to you, somebody that's your Lord. When you acknowledge Jesus as the Lord of your life, he becomes your Savior from sin. When the sinner prostrates himself before the cross, what does she say happened? A new creation. The Holy Spirit gives that person a new heart. Let me ask you this question, friend. Unless the Holy Spirit has given you a new heart, unless the Holy Spirit has given me a new heart, all of our profession of religion is for nothing. I'm sorry if that sounded vehement, but it's the truth. Do you have a new heart? Are you a new creation? Have old things passed away? Is everything new? Let me tell you, when that happens, your husband will know about it. Your wife will know about it. Your children will know about it. The people that you work with will know about it. You won't have to tell them. They'll know something's changed. Has that happened to you? It will happen if you prostrate yourself in front of the cross. You study out what that means. Let me finish the paragraph. He says, a new heart is given him. He becomes a new creature in Christ Jesus. Holiness finds that it has nothing more to require. There are some people that are absolutely terrified of the day of judgment, and with good reason. because they know that they're not holy. And the Bible says if you're not holy, there's no chance you're going to go to heaven. But you can become holy because the Holy Spirit will make you holy. That's what I just read. And then when holiness looks at you, holiness says, there's nothing more to require. God doesn't do imperfect work. Then she says, after she says that holiness finds that it has nothing more to require, God himself is the justifier of him who believeth in Jesus, Romans 3:26. And whom he justified him, them he also glorified, Romans 8:30. Great as is the shame and degradation through sin, even greater will be the honor and exaltation through redeeming love. To human beings striving for conformity to the divine image, there is imparted an outlay. You know what an outlay is? An outlay is when you take something out and you... an outlay of what? Well, now notice what there's going to be an outlay of. To human beings striving for conformity to the divine image, there is imparted an outlay of heaven's treasure. How much? Listen. An excellency of power that will place them higher than even the angels who have never fallen. Now, I don't understand that at all. But it's written. I read it to you. God has all the power you need to become a reflection of Jesus Christ. He has all the power you need. And if there's anybody here and you're saying, well, I'm weak. The weaker you are, that all that means you need more help. But God has all the help you need. He has all the power you need. Even if you're the weakest one. Has the Holy Spirit given you a new heart? The Holy Spirit must give to you and to me a new heart, or we will never be prepared to meet God, no matter how religious we are. Well, let's go to point number five. Point number five is, if ever a people needed to walk before God as did Enoch, Seventh-day Adventists need to now. What is the walk of Enoch? You know, the Bible says that Enoch walked with God, and Ellen White says Adventists need to do that now, what Enoch did. They need to walk with God. Well, we need to make sure that we keep things simple. I've learned that if we don't keep things simple, we end up, even preachers sometimes don't know what they're talking about because they're using too big of words and they don't know the meaning of what they're talking about. I'd better not get into that. I have sat in audiences and listened to preachers preach, and while trying not to be disrespectful, not say anything out loud so that my family would get the wrong idea, in my mind I was saying, brother, you don't know what you're talking about. I've looked up the meaning of those words, and they don't mean that at all. So we need to keep things simple so that we know what we're talking about. That's why, by the way, I have never been opposed to people reading Bibles that are written in simple language. Now, my wife's going to tell me I'm getting in trouble, but I'm going to say it anyway. It is all right to read Bibles, including the New International Version, that are written in simple language so that people can understand. It's all right. I know many people that have been converted reading these Bibles who, before they had these Bibles, had a Bible that they said, I can't understand what it's saying. You need a Bible that you understand. If English is not your mother tongue, you need to get a Bible in your mother tongue so you understand what you're reading. We use this cliche, say, well, Enoch walked with God. We talk about walking with God. What in the world are we talking about? Let's try to make it simple. I'll describe it in terms of Enoch. Enoch was a busy man. Like I told you, I preached whole sermons just on Enoch. And I've looked up everything I could find in the spirit of prophecy in the Bible about Enoch. Enoch is mentioned in Hebrews 11 as well as in Genesis 5. Enoch was the first person who was translated to heaven. Enoch is over 5,000 years old. He's in heaven now. Well, he may not be in heaven now. He may be visiting someplace. Ellen White in vision visited with Enoch. You can read about it in the book Early Writings. And when Ellen White was in vision, we're going to talk about this, if the Lord wills, at prayer meeting. Ellen White was having what we call today an out-of-body experience. Well, that's not our subject. But she was talking with Enoch, and she wasn't on this world. In her mind, she was talking with Enoch on another planet. And she talks about the conversation that they had. But Enoch, when he lived in this world for 365 years, he started a walk with God when he was 65 years old. He started a walk with God when he was 65 years old, and he walked with God for 300 years. And after he'd walked with God for 300 years, the Lord took him to heaven. And we are to have the same experience that Enoch had. Now, Enoch was a husband, number one. Number two, Enoch was a father. Methuselah was not Enoch's only child. He had sons and daughters. That is number two. Number three, Enoch was a preacher. Number four, Enoch was a citizen. We don't know very much about the society that they had then, but he was a member of society. He was a citizen. And Ellen White says he had responsibilities not just as a husband, not just as a father, not just as a preacher, but he had responsibilities as a citizen. And then in addition to that, like most of you, in fact, I hope all of you, Enoch had some special friends. And so he had responsibilities to all. He had responsibilities to his wife. He had responsibilities to his children. He had a responsibility to provide for his family. He had to work for a living. Enoch, by the way, was not a rich man. That's not the subject. He had to work for a living. He was a preacher. He was a prophet. And he had responsibilities as a citizen. And he had responsibilities to his friends. And because of that, actually, Enoch was a very busy man. Enoch was not a man that just went off in some monastery, convent, cave, church, somewhere off in seclusion and so that he could be holy. No, Enoch's life was a very busy life in society. He had all these obligations to all these different people. First his wife and his children, but then in addition to that, he had responsibilities as a citizen, as a preacher, and as a friend, and he had responsibilities to support his family. And so he was a busy man. But while Enoch was engaged in all of these activities that were activities that he had to do, he was so busy that he decided he needed to talk to the Lord about what he was doing. So while he was doing his work, whether it was for his wife, his children, his friends, as a citizen, as a preacher, or supporting his family, He was busy, and so he would talk to the Lord while he was engaged in all of his other activities. And that is how Enoch walked with God. Now, Enoch also took occasion sometimes when he went alone for periods of time to pray, just spend time in prayer. That's the purpose of meetings like camp meeting, so that people have time to get away from what they're doing to earn a living. They have time to specially seek the Lord. That's important. But most of the time, Enoch was living something very similar to the kind of life you live. He had all these different kind of responsibilities the way you have. And how did he deal with all that when he was so busy? In the midst of all his activities, Enoch talked to the Lord. He talked to the Lord about everything. You can talk to the Lord about everything in your life. Are you doing that? Whenever Enoch had to make a decision, Ellen White says that he would ask the question, now, if I do this, will this be pleasing to the Lord? He was always asking that question. Now, if every time I made a decision, I was always asking, would that be pleasing to the Lord? Might that change any of my decisions? Something else I'll mention quickly about Enoch. Ellen White says that while Enoch was living down here below, in his imagination, He was thinking about the realms of light. He was down here in the body, but in his mind, in his imagination, he was already up there. Do you know what that did to him? That changed the way he talked. It changed his conduct with people. Well, maybe that'll be enough for right now. I have statements here from the Spirit of Prophecy about Enoch. Maybe I'll read just one. Here's what it says. As we walk in the streets with those who care not for God or heaven or heavenly things, we can talk to them of Jesus. We have something more precious than they to look upon. It is Jesus. He is with us in the moral darkness of this age. We can tell him of the afflictions of our soul and the wickedness in the world, and none of these things need hinder us. We can talk with Jesus. We can talk with Jesus as Enoch talked with God. He could tell his Lord all about his trials. Here was the way Enoch walked with God. And when the light shone out upon his pathway, he did not expect to say, "Why, what will my friends and relatives say of me if I take this course?" No, he did that which was right, whatever the consequence. We're to walk with God like Enoch if we're going to be ready to meet our Maker. We need to learn to walk with God as Enoch. If you need that reference, that's 9 Manuscript Releases, page 256. We talked about moral renovation. That's point number 7. I mentioned that I wasn't going to say anything about point number 8, which is Romans 12, which that point in itself has 40 points. Romans 12 has 40 points all by itself. We studied that already. But I want to go to the last point of all, so we'll have time to cover it, which is this. Point number 9. Those whose faith is spurious will show by their daily exhibition of character that they are not true Christians. Those who have put on Christ are transformed by the renewing of their minds. I want to ask you, friend, has your mind been transformed? Has your mind been renewed so that your experience is transformed? We're living in a world where there are many people who claim to be Christians, who claim to be God's children, but they really are not. Did you notice that it talked about those whose faith is spurious? And she said they will show by their daily exhibition of character that they are not true Christians. Let me read to you a statement along that line from the book Prophets and Kings. She says, "The world today has its Ahabs and its Jezebels. The present age is one of idolatry, as verily as was that in which Elijah lived." Now, when I first read these Ellen White statements, and I first read that statement there, I can't remember how many decades ago, several, I never could figure it out. I had a trouble reasoning, because she said, we're living in an age of idolatry just like Elijah. And I, in my mind, because I was just young and, I guess, stupid, I couldn't figure that out, because I didn't know anybody that... Oh well, I shouldn't say didn't know anybody. I did know some Roman Catholics who would kneel down in front of images of the Virgin Mary. I did know that. But other than those Roman Catholics that kneel down in front of crucifixes or images of the Virgin Mary, I thought, you know, most of the people I know are Protestants. They don't worship idols. Oh, they don't? Did you know that Protestants worship idols too? It's not just the Roman Catholics that worship idols. It's not just the Sunday keepers that worship idols. Even Adventists worship idols. Now look. Now notice carefully how she specifies what this idolatry is. She said, "No outward shrine may be visible. There may be no image for the eye to rest upon. Yet thousands are following after the gods of this world." Now notice she's going to specify what the idols are. Here they are. The gods of this world, after riches, that's one. Fame, that's two. Pleasure, that's three. And then this fourth one. and the pleasing fables that permit man to follow the inclinations of the unregenerate heart. What are the pleasing fables that allow men to follow the impulses of the unregenerate, that's the unconverted heart? What are those? Oh, friend, that is what Paul is talking about in 2 Thessalonians 2. Turn in your Bible to 2 Thessalonians 2. It says, verses 9 to 12, it says, the coming of the lawless one, that's the Antichrist, is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie. The definite article is in the Greek. That they should believe the lie. What is the lie? I think I preached a whole sermon on this, but it was in New Zealand, so probably you weren't there. Should have read to verse 12. What is the lie? You can study it out for yourself. I'll just tell you quickly, and you can study it out for yourself. The lie that is promoted by Antichrist and is believed by most of the Protestant world and now is believed by some people that are Adventists is the lie that you can be saved in your sins. That is the lie. That is idolatry. People are not trying to overcome their sins because they believe they can be saved in their sins. Their sins are their idol. They love them more than they love the Lord Jesus. That is the lie. Oh, friend, if you've been following the lie, you are lost. You will never be saved while you believe and follow the lie. If you believe that you can be saved in your sins, you won't try to overcome your sins, and you will be lost. That's the lie. That is the lie that has caused billions of people in this world to be lost. That's why it's called the lie. That was the lie that the pagan religions taught. That was the lie that the Roman Catholic Church taught in the Dark Ages and still teaching. That's the lie that the Protestant churches now are teaching. By the way, the Protestant reformers, Martin Luther and John Calvin, didn't teach that. When Martin Luther was still a Catholic priest and people bought indulgences and came to him, he would not give them absolution. He would not give them forgiveness of sins. Protestant reformers, whatever mistakes they made, they all understood what the lie was. Martin Luther and John Wesley and all the different Protestant reformers used to preach many, many sermons about the Ten Commandments and about the necessity of keeping the Ten Commandments. John Wesley was very clear that you could not go to the kingdom of heaven if you were a breaker of the Ten Commandments. Because that's living in sin. That's the lie. She says, multitudes have a wrong conception of God and His attributes and are truly serving a false God as were the worshippers of Baal. Many, even of those who claim to be Christians, have allied themselves with influences that are unalterably opposed to God and His truth. Thus, they are led to turn away from the divine and to exalt the human. Well, the time is coming when whether you've believed the lie or whether you have not believed the lie, whether you're ready or whether you're not ready, the time's coming when you and I are going to meet our Maker. And, old friend, I want you to be ready. We just went through the principles you need to follow and study if you're going to be ready. Is your religion real? Have you been born again? Do you have a new heart? Do you love Jesus, or do you feel more comfortable when you're talking about something else? Ellen White wrote about people that thought they were Christians, but they weren't. Let me read you what she says about this. He says, all disunion, all selfish thoughts, words, and actions are the fruit of the working of an unholy spirit upon the mind. This is a powerful sentence. I better read that again. Here it is. All disunion, all selfish thoughts, words, and actions are the fruit of the working of an unholy spirit upon the mind. Under the influence of this spirit, words are spoken which do not reveal the Savior. Christ is not formed within the hope of glory. Those who live thus are sinners, though they may be disguised as saints. A saint is a holy person. That's what a saint is. Are you a saint or are you just disguised as a saint? Which is it? I have a statement here that we won't take time to read because we're running out of time about people that they think they're saved, but they're self-deceived. One final question before we quit. We talked about, do you love Jesus? Do you love your neighbor as yourself? Now, when this comes up, there's always some people that have some very troubled thoughts, and they're apt to challenge the preacher and say, don't you understand what this person did to me? And I want to read to you about how do you deal with somebody that is your neighbor that's done some awful things. Do you have any neighbors that have done awful things? Most people do. How do you relate to all that? Well, here's the answer. This is from Signs of the Times, January 7, 1897. You may see nothing to love in your neighbor's course of action, but this the Lord does not require of you. It is your neighbor himself, not what he does. It is your neighbor himself, the soul God has purchased at an infinite cost that he would have you love. You may say, I can never do this. But if you do not, you are not a partaker of the divine nature. You can never behold the purity of heaven, never walk the golden streets. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord, and only by obeying the dictates of God's will can you make it manifest that you have attained to this perfection. Oh, friend, are you prepared to meet God? Are you preparing to meet God? Do you really love Jesus? Do you love your neighbors yourself? Not what your neighbor does. Unless you do, you can't go to heaven. Unless you prostrate yourself at the foot of the cross so that you receive a new spirit, you can't go to heaven. If you want to go to heaven, you need a new spirit, a new mind, new speech, and you need family religion. Oh, friend, you and I are going to meet again the day of judgment, even if you don't meet again here. I want you to be ready. Before we sing our closing song, let's pray that we'll be ready. I want to pray for you. You pray for yourself while I'm praying for you, won't you? Make a decision. Say, Lord, I want to be ready. I want to be prepared to meet my Maker. Let's pray together before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, I pray for each person here because we all have an appointment. We're going to meet you. You have told us that we're going to meet you. You have arranged this appointment, and we pray that you will help us to understand what we need to do to be ready. I pray for each person here as we're looking to you that make that decision and say, Lord, help me that I may prostrate myself at the foot of the cross so that I might receive a new heart and a new spirit. Help me to have not just church religion, but family religion. Recreate within me, O Lord, that new spirit, so that I will love you with all my heart, soul, and mind, and my neighbors myself. And I pray that the blood of Jesus may not have been poured out in vain for my soul. I pray this in behalf of each soul here this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of his might and the strength of his power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above all the earth.